Hariom. Start with the study about skeletal system or the bones. In the last session we talked about the muscles, so we follow it up with the bones, because these two things definitely they are directly related with the yogasana practice. So this is just an overview of the skeleton, the bones, a back view and the front view. So it's just, many a times I call it as the internal beauty. No matter how beautiful you are outside, inside we are all like this. But then definitely it's an internal beauty, because it gives support, it gives strength to our body. The bones as such, what we have as a grown-up individual, as an adult individual, the bones, they are strong, they are hard, they are having strength. But then these bones, they are not the same when they are actually being produced, when they are being formed. The process of bone formation is called as ossification, and this process, it starts usually during the third, fourth month of pregnancy. So when the baby is actually growing in the mother's womb, at that time the bones, they start developing. And these bones, they are just represented by a thin membrane. It's just a membrane, nothing more than that. And over this membrane, there is deposition of calcium, magnesium, and some amounts of phosphorus. It's mainly calcium, less of magnesium, and least of phosphorus. So it's mainly calcium, you can say. So there is a deposition of calcium over this membrane. The mineral, calcium mineral, is deposited over the membrane, and this membrane, it slowly gets converted into a cartilage. Cartilage, you can say, it's a soft bone. For example, the tip of our nose, it's a cartilage. The ear, it's a cartilage. So they are having some strength, but at the same time, it's flexible. So when you start having layers after layers of this calcium over the membrane, that membrane gets converted into a cartilage. And this process, it further continues, that there is deposition of calcium over the cartilage now, and this cartilage, now it converts itself into a strong, hard bone. Now this whole process is called as the process of ossification. It starts around third or fourth month of pregnancy, and it continues even after birth. So it's not that only during pregnancy the baby will have this process. It also continues after birth. A very simple thing, like for example, if you see a small kid, maybe this height, and then after 6 months you visit the same home and you see the kid, what's the major difference? The difference is obviously the height is increased. Definitely the internal organs have also increased in size and function and everything, but then what we notice is increase in height. And that increase in height of that kid is because of the process of ossification. Because when the layer of calcium is deposited, layer after layer, one after another, one, then the second, the third, the fourth, it will go on. What would happen is the thickness of the bone, it will increase. And at the same time, the length of the bone will go on increasing. Because it's layers of calcium. So the size, the thickness, the length of the bone, it will go on increasing, increasing and increasing. And obviously when the size, when the length of the bone increases, the height of that kid, the height of that child will go on increasing. So the process of ossification is very important for the increase in the height of that person. But sadly, this process, it stops around the age of 20 years. So roughly around the age of 20 years, depends on your genetic factors, depends on the diet and many other things, but then roughly at the age of 20 years, this process of ossification, it stops. Or in other words, I can say that the height of the person would not increase beyond the age of 20 years. By that time, the height can increase because the process is going on. Bone formation is going on, so the height will increase. I am just emphasizing this thing a bit more, because in the books you will come across that some yoga postures, the benefits have been mentioned, that you practice this yoga posture and your height will increase. For example, the tree pose. For For example, the triangle pose. For example, the warrior pose. Under the benefits, it has been mentioned that it helps to increase the height. But the books have not mentioned that if you practice this asanas before the ossification. You can't expect at the age of 25 or 30 years, okay, I'm practicing the tree pose, so my height will increase. That's not going to happen. Yoga is a science, it's not a magic. So if you practice those asanas before the ossification is completed, only then you will get those benefits. But then obviously it's one of the benefits. Tree pose has other benefits also. You can practice tree pose. It doesn't mean that after age of 20 you stop practicing tree pose. No, you will get other benefits of it. But then sometimes some people may come to you, they have read it somewhere, because nowadays information is freely available. So they will come to you and they will say, oh, tree pose and warrior pose, I have heard, I have read that increases my height, it can increase the height. I am a bit short, can you help me with yoga? Check on the age. That's very important. And obviously a proper age with a proper calcium diet, definitely yoga practice will help you to increase the height. But then don't overlook the genetic factors. Don't expect miracles to happen, but then definitely it would be beneficial. Then coming to the components of the bone, everyone knows bone is made up of calcium, no doubt about it. But then the bone, 70% of the bone is calcium. Remaining 30% is proteins, fats and carbohydrates. So that 70%, we call it as a inorganic content or a dead matter, which is minerals and salts. And the 30% is proteins, fats and carbohydrates, which is actually the living organism or the living matter. Now this 70% of calcium, it gives strength to the bone. So whatever strength of the bone, it is because of the calcium, 70% of it. And our bones, they are a little bit flexible, and that flexibility is because of the 30% proteins, fats and carbohydrates. So our bones are strong and hard, but at the same time they are a little bit flexible because of proteins, fats and carbohydrates. Now one very important thing, this what we said 70% and 30% is in adults. You and me, we are having this 70 and 30. But the situation is not the same in childhood. In childhood, the calcium is less. The proportion of proteins, fats and carbohydrates in a child are more as compared to calcium. Simple reasoning behind it, just a couple of minutes we talked about ossification, and ossification is calcium depositing in the bones. So I can say that children, they are having less calcium. The bones are being formed, it's not completely developed, so it's less of calcium in children. So children, they are having bones which are more flexible with less strength. And that is one of the reasons maybe why the ancient texts on yoga have mentioned that children should not practice yoga. And when they said yoga, more specifically we are talking about yogasana postures. So the books had mentioned that, okay, children should not practice yogasana. The reason was the flexibility of the bones. The bones are not strong, the bones are not hard. So there is a possibility that the bones, because of pressure, they may develop bends, abnormal curves, because traditional yoga practice, it is actually holding the postures. That's what is mentioned. So if a kid holds the posture for a long time, he can develop the bend, he can develop the curvature. So children are not expected to practice yoga. Now you would obviously ask, oh yes, what about kids yoga TTC? Everywhere we have the kids yoga practice. But then you have to modify the things. What modification and other things, it's a separate subject, but then you can modify the things. For example, you don't make the kids to hold the posture for long times. Just getting into the postures and releasing the postures, maybe that can be a modification. So certain differences can be brought up and children can be taught yoga. But then as such, holding of the postures and other things, strictly children are not allowed for that. And the second question which comes up is, obviously when I say children, what's the age? So around the age of 12 years, I would say around the age of 12 years, now strictly you can't say 12 years, but roughly around the age of 12 years, that's childhood. And after that, slowly you can introduce the holding of postures gently and slowly. It's not that till 12 years he was a child and at the age of 12 years immediately has become adult, so directly shift the practice of asana. That's not a switch on off mechanism. You have to slowly shift towards the traditional practice of yoga. So by the age of 12 years, he can just go for kids yoga, and after the age of 12 years around, slowly he can build up with the traditional practice of yoga. Another thing is about old age. So one is children, the other extreme is old age. What about yoga practice during old age? Yoga practice is definitely not contraindicated in old age. At whatsoever age you want to practice yoga, you can practice yoga. 60 years, 70 years, 80 years, 90 years. Someone comes to you at the age of 70 years and says, I want to learn yoga. I have never done yoga in my life. Now at the age of 70, I have some time. I want to practice yoga. Can I do that? The answer is yes. Yoga practice can be done at old age also. There is no contraindication for yoga practice. The only thing you need to remember is your own limitation. You can't do it as a young person. So old people, they can learn yoga, but then respect your own limitations and practice yoga. So each and every asana has certain contraindications. Just check for those contraindications and then practice the asanas. Because at an old age, for example, the person is suffering from high blood pressure. So obviously inverted postures will not be allowed. So that contraindications are to be respected and yoga practice is to be continued in old age. Next, we talk about joints. Now, when we are talking about the skeleton, when we are talking about the bones, the most important thing is obviously joints. Because if you don't have a joint, just imagine what would happen. Single bone, top to bottom, no movements. Even I can't speak. If there is no joint here, I would not be able to speak. So joints are necessary for movements, very important. So we will just try to understand how a specific joint is designed in our body. So one very important thing for a joint formation, you need at least two bones. There can be more than two bones in one single joint. There can be. A simple example is elbow joint. In elbow, we have three bones, actually. So minimum requirement for a joint formation is two bones. So these two bones, but interestingly, they never touch each other. You can see the picture if you want. So the two bones, they are never touching each other. There is always a gap. There is always a space in between the ends of the two bones. So that when the joint is moving, when the bones are moving, there would be no friction in between the bones. If there is a friction, you would have pain. So to avoid that friction, each and every joint in our body has a little bit of gap, a little bit of space, which is called as a joint space. Now, interestingly, that joint space is filled up with a sticky lubricant, a sticky liquid, you can say. And that sticky liquid, it further prevents the friction between the bones. Sticky, oily liquid. Sometimes in old age, the physician tells some people that, okay, the fluid in the joint has been reduced. That's possible because that fluid is recycled in our joint. So that sticky, oily fluid, it further lubricates the joint whenever the joint is moving and we don't have the pain. And in some strong joints, in some major joints in our body, there is a disc of cartilage in between the two bones. There is a disc which is made up of cartilage in between. The function is the same, to prevent friction. So the design is such that whenever the joint is moving, the friction will be minimized. And very interestingly, this all structure, it is enclosed in a bag, in a membrane, which is called as a synovial membrane. Simple thing, as I said, it's a fluid there. The fluid should not go away from that place. So what is to be done? There is a membrane which is covering the ends of the bones. And this membrane will hold the fluid in position. Now, one very important and very interesting function is this membrane, the cells of this membrane, they can recycle the fluid. When the fluid is bad, when it's not properly functioning, you can recycle the fluid by the cells of this membrane. I just give you a simple example actually. Most of you, I think you drive a car. So after a few kilometers, what do you do with the engine oil? It's a dirty thing. So what you do is you just drain out the old engine oil and you add new engine oil, a new lubricant, right? Every now and then we take the car to the service station and you get it done. So the oil which is in our joints, you can't do that with the oil in the joints. So you just drain out the oil and you fill up new oil in there. That's practically not possible. So the cells there, they recycle the oil, they recycle the fluid. And this recycling process, it slows down with the age. And then the doctor will tell you, oh yes, the joint fluid, the fluid in your joint, it is reduced. Why it is reduced? Because the cells are not recycling it properly. And one of the benefits at a physical level with yoga practice is you increase the blood circulation to the joints. And when you increase the blood circulation to the joints, this recycling of the oily fluid is enhanced, it is improved, and yoga practice is indicated for these purposes. Because many a times people ask, I'm having arthritis, should I do yoga? The answer is yes. I'm having maybe less of fluid in my joints, can I do yogasana? There is a little bit of pain when I move the joints. The answer is yes. Continue the yoga practice. But definitely not a strong, very strong yoga practice, but you can go for a gentle yoga practice, improve the blood circulation to your joints and improve the recycling of the fluid in your joint spaces. That is practically possible. The fluid levels can increase. So yoga practice would help you for this recycling of the fluid. Because most of the people nowadays, they have this complaint in a very early age. Forget about old age, at 40s or even at the age of 40, 45, there is a trouble with the joints. It can be beneficial. Now, further going to the types of joints, you can see here the joints are broadly classified into two types. One is a mobile joint and another one is the fixed joint. So, as the name itself is suggestive, the fixed joint is a joint where there is no movement possible. For example, the skull joints, there is no movement, but then still there is a joint. And on the other hand, there are mobile joints. There are four types of them. I'll just show you the pictures and then you can correlate the names with them. The four types of mobile joints. The first one is the ball and socket joint. So the one which you can see here is the hip joint. We can rotate our hip, right? That's because it's a ball and socket joint. Another example is our shoulder joint. You can rotate your shoulder. That's because it's a ball and socket. This action, you can see, it's a rotation action. So that's a ball and socket joint. The next is a hinge joint. The picture what you see here is the picture of the elbow joint, this one. So when you bend the elbow, you can just bend the elbow in one direction. A better example, I would say, is the knee joint. Knee joint is a hinge joint. What does that mean? It simply means that the movement is possible in one direction. If in your yoga class also, simple example, in your yoga class, when the teacher tells you bend your knee, do you anytime question him which direction to bend it? You never question which direction I should bend my knee. You bend the knee. Why? Because movement is possible only in one direction. Similarly, the fingers, you can bend the fingers only this way. You can't go the other way. There might be some hyperflexible people who sometimes they can do that, but generally it's this one. So it's a hinge joint where movement is possible only in one direction. Then the third one is the sliding joint. Some books, they mention it as the gliding joint. Sliding or gliding, it's one and the same. So the joint which is shown here is the wrist joint. You can see there are two bones in the breast. You can see two prominences here, one and two. So when you are moving your wrist, this movement of your wrist, these two bones here, they are remaining firm. They are not moving at all. But then the other bones, they are sliding over it or gliding over it. So that's the wrist joint. And the third one is pivotal joint. It's in our neck, the first and the second bone of our neck. And it's a very interesting and unique joint only in our neck. So the second bone of our neck, it looks something like this. The second in the neck. So this is the main bone and it has a projection upwards, a pivot, a projection. So this is the second bone. And over that, the first bone is encircling it. So this is the first bone over the second bone. And obviously over this first bone on the top is the skull. So this is the second bone, the first bone, and on the top is the skull. So when you're doing this action, shoulder to shoulder action, then I ask you, should I continue with the lecture? You go on doing like this. So that's the action, no action or shoulder to shoulder action. The second bone remains firm, the first bone, it rotates. Rotates, or you can say half rotation. And obviously when this bone is moving, the skull over it is going to move. So that's the pivotal joint. It's present only in our neck. Then the most interesting part, what we will be focusing is actually the vertebral column or the backbone. Very important to understand about the backbone. Now, we call it as a backbone, but then it's not one single bone as such. There are multiple bones in our back which are placed one above the other in a chain-like structure. So, out of that, seven bones, they are located in our neck region, which you can see is called as the cervical region. Seven vertebra, the individual name for each and every bone is vertebra. So seven bones or seven vertebra in the neck region. Then in the chest region, at the backside, there are 12 vertebra. Below the chest region, it comes up is the lumbar region. In the lumbar region, there are 5 vertebras. And below that is the sacrum and coccyx. Now even different scientists, they are fighting over it, whether they are 5 bones or 6 bones or whatever. We are not interested in that fight. But then you can just say that it's a bone which is fused together. The sacrum and the coccygeal bones, they are all fused together. And so they are fighting around, whether they are 5 or 6 or 7, whatever. And you can just simply say they are fused together. But then everyone will have 7 in the neck, 12 in the chest region, 5 in the lumbar region, and below that it's a fusion. The sacrum and the coccyx is the fusion of bones. Now, in between these bones, in between these vertebrae, you can see there is always a disc of cartilage. The principle is the same. When you are bending forwards, backwards, sideways, anyways, the disc of cartilage will prevent the friction between the two vertebrae so that the pain is minimized, or rather I would say there is no pain at all. Now, another interesting thing, these vertebrae, these bones, they are placed one above the other, but they are not in a straight line. You can see that. They are not in a straight line. There are 4 natural curves in our back. Some books, they mention 3.5. Doesn't matter, 3.5 or 4 curves. So these 4 curves, it's even you can feel it on your own body when you are sitting erect. The first curve in the neck region, you can see it's a bit forward curve. Then in the chest region, you can feel the chest is a bit backward curving. In the lumbar area, you can feel in your lumbar area, the lumbar area is a bit forward bending. And below the lumbar area, the sacral, it's again a backward curve. So first curve in the neck, second curve in the chest, third curve in the lower back, lumbar area, and the sacral curve is called as a half curve. So coming out, bulging out. Can nothing matters, you call it a complete curve, doesn't matter. So 3.5 or 4 curves in our back. Now, these curves, they are needed for balancing our body. If we have a straight vertebral column, if we have a straight backbone, practically we would not be able to balance ourselves. Because as human beings, we are balancing on two legs. There is no other creature, no other animal in this world who balances on two legs. All of them are on four legs. The lion, the tiger, the cat, even the chimpanzees, the monkeys also. They have to balance on four legs. Two legs, sometimes they will stand on two legs, but mostly it is balancing on four legs. So that balance is maintained by the typical structure of our backbone. If you don't have this curves in our back, balancing becomes difficult. So that is the importance, that is the significance why we have curves. Sometimes we just say that sit straight, but sitting straight is practically not possible. Because if you try to sit straight, you're going to break your back. So the proper English word I would say is sitting erect. The structure what you see here, that's an erect structure. It's not a straight line, but it's an erect structure. Now, one thing which is related with the backbone and yogic practices is actually related with our developmental process. A human baby, small human baby, have you seen the baby infant, I would say, immediately after birth starts walking? Human? Never, practically not possible. So after birth, the human infant cannot walk. Such a great creation of God, the highest creation, I would say, but we can't walk immediately after birth. And then what about the other animals? The elephant, the cow, the buffalo, the giraffe. Immediately after birth, they start walking. But why not we as an infant? One of the reasons behind that, obviously brain and muscles and everything is involved, no doubt about it. But one of the reasons behind that is that our vertebral column doesn't have these curves when we are born. So we actually cannot stand on our legs. At the time of our birth, there is no curves in our vertebral column. The next thing, when you carry a baby, actually a very newborn baby, the first precaution, everyone knows it throughout the world, you support the neck, right? Why? Because if you don't support the neck, the baby will throw the neck backwards. But then after a few months, the mother is very happy. Why she is happy? Because she says, my baby has started holding the neck, right? She's very happy with that achievement, that my baby is able to hold the neck or hold the head. So what has happened? The first curve, it has developed, and obviously the muscles also have developed, no doubt about it. So the first curve, the first muscles have developed, and the baby can balance the head. So if you just go through the balancing mechanism of the baby, or rather the development of the baby, initially the baby is just lying down on the floor or just on the mat, for example. And what are the movements? Just the movements of hands and legs, nothing more than that. Just moving their head here and there, that's it. Then after a few months, the baby, which is lying on its back, it rolls over, right? And again, you are happy with that. The baby has started rolling over or turning over, whatever the word is used. So the baby rolls over. So the movement is, it rolls over on its abdomen. Then maybe starts crawling. Then starts or learns to sit. And then learns to stand. Obviously in between it is with support and then without support and many other things. But then usually the process is lying on the back, then lying on the abdomen, then sitting and then standing. So this is the way the baby will develop. And what's the correlation of this thing with yoga practice? We are talking about yoga. So what it has to do with yoga? This is the way our brain has learned to balance our body. And so the same sequence is to be followed in your yoga practice. So when you are doing the asanas, first asanas lying on the back, then asanas lying on your abdomen, then sitting position and standing position. Because lying on your back, your brain has to take minimum efforts to balance. Lying on the abdomen also, hardly any efforts. Sitting, yes, the brain has to take efforts to balance when you are sitting. And what about standing? The maximum efforts are required when you are in a standing position to balance yourselves. So the sequence of asanas is going to be the same. Teaching the asanas, learning the asanas, or even the asana practice in your daily practice. Like, I have been practicing asanas for the last 25 years. It doesn't matter. No. Every day is a new day. Start with this same sequence of asanas. It's very important so that your brain, your body, and your systems get used to this balancing mechanism. So definitely this one point is to be followed when you are teaching asanas or when you yourselves are practicing asana positions. Don't directly start with the standing positions. Start from the prone, supine, sitting, standing. Go in the same sequence. Then one more important thing, when we talk about the joints, the utilization of joints in our day-to-day life, it can be in three ways. Now, these three ways, I'll just summarize it. One is overusing the joints. Second is no utilization of the joints. And the third is misusing the joints. Overuse, no use, and misuse. Simple examples we can talk of. Overusing the joints. I can give my own example. Last maybe 1.5 hours continuously, blah, 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 going on. Overuse. Depends on your profession, actually. Maybe for a cop, for a policeman, controlling the traffic, has to stand there at one place for 8 hours. So maybe overusing his knee joint. The nursing staff, continuously standing, maybe overusing the knee joint. Nowadays, they have come up with a research, new research for children. You know that new research? What is the joint which children are using maximum? Continuously, thumb joint. Okay, so they came up with a research. I don't know why you need to research for this, just to get funds and everything. No need of research. It's a world known fact, obvious, yes. But they had a research and they came with a conclusion that children are using this joint more. Okay, yes, no problem. So depends on what work you are doing. Some joint in your body is overused. On the other hand, sometimes some joints in your body, they are not used. No utilization of the joint. Like, the movement is possible, but we do not utilize that movement. The commonest is backward bending movements. So many a times, day-to-day life, we don't bend backwards. Forward bending is quite common, quite often, but we don't bend backwards. Maybe side bending. Maybe twisting. We don't do that. Movement is possible, but we don't do that. So no movement of the joint. And the third one is misusing the joint. Misusing is like we are using the joint, but in a wrong way. So you are utilizing, but in a wrong way. The commonest example is standing. When we are standing, what usually we do? Mostly one leg is used more, like we go on one leg. Ideally, when we are standing, the weight should be transmitted equally through both the legs. But many a times it happens that we go towards the left or towards the right, something like that. And especially if you are having a bag on your back, a backpack, then mostly it happens. You are having the backpack on your left side, so you tend to go on the left side, and then you take the backpack on your right side, and then you go towards your left side, something like that. So it's misusing the joints. Many things. Like, for example, sitting erect, this position is the ideal position. But then throughout the day, just self-analyze yourselves. How many hours, how many minutes, I would say, you sit erect. So if you're not maintaining this position of your backbone, obviously you are misusing the joints. So what is happening basically because of this overuse, misuse, and no use? At a medical level, I would say that you are gathering the toxins, the metabolic toxins in your joint spaces. Remember the joint space, the fluid and everything. So if you are misusing, if you are overusing, if you are not using the joints properly, the metabolic waste products, they develop a tendency to accumulate in the joint spaces. The most commonest, I think you know the word, is uric acid. Everyone, I think, has this word uric acid, or maybe you have heard of the disease word gout. Oh, he or she is suffering from gout. So what is it? It's basically accumulation of uric acid. It's one of the waste products. There are multiple, many of them. So what yoga is going to do at a physical level, again, I'm talking at a physical level. If you start practicing yoga, a proper yoga practice, you're actually going to increase the blood circulation to all those joints. And once you improve the blood circulation to all those joints, obviously fresh blood supply, removal of toxins, removal of metabolic waste products from that joint spaces, and you are going to increase the life of that joint. So with yoga practice, the stiffness, the pain in joints and other things, they are reduced because of yoga practices. It's just like maybe, for example, the door here. If you don't open the door for next 10 years, everyone knows what would happen with the door. And after 10 years, you come back to the ashram and you feel, oh, I need to open this door or I need to open this window. You know, it's difficult because it's all rusted. So that rust is our metabolic waste. So if actually I would go to that extent that if you use the joints properly throughout the day, there is no need of practicing yoga actually. At a physical level, I'm talking, not the other benefits I'm talking of. So if you're using each and every joint properly, there is no question of practicing yoga. For example, half spinal twist. I'll just give one example and then maybe I would stop. So half spinal twist, for example. Everyone by this time, I think, knows half spinal twist. So when you're working in your office, maybe you have a main table in front of you, working on a laptop or a computer, whatever, and you have a side table where there are papers and files and everything. So you're working on a computer and you want to take up a file. You want to take up a paper from the side table. How do you usually go for that? What about the chair? Huh? It's a swirling chair. You swirl the chair, go for the documents, again swirl back and start working. Ideally, if this kind of chair, what you would have to do? You are sitting, working, you have to twist, go for the chair and again come. Ideally. So what is this? What you are doing? Not necessary that you should be on a mat with a designer yoga costume and then practicing the half spinal twist. You can do it here, right? So, but we are not doing it. So it creates one of the reasons why yoga is to be practiced daily. It's not that once in a week, twice in a week, I have a yoga practice. No. Many times I'm just randomly saying this whenever I receive the applications in the experience, many students, they mention yoga practice twice a week for last 3 years. Okay, why twice a week? Why can't you go daily? Because if you're going for a daily yoga practice, then only you will get these benefits. And when you are scheduling your daily yoga practice, you need to take these points into consideration about your lifestyle. About what joints you are overusing, about what joints you are misusing, about what joints you are not using. Say for example, if your job is of standing throughout the day, you'll focus more on inversions because that's your requirement. If your job is continuously bending forwards and working on a machine or something, you will focus more on bending backwards. You will balance your movements in that maybe half hour, 45 minutes or 1 hour of yoga practice. That yoga practice is not that because my friend is doing inversions, so let me do the inversions. My friend does inversions for half an hour, so I will also do inversions for half an hour. No. Find out if it's your requirement, find out what is your lifestyle, and of course the contraindications. And then you can design a daily yoga practice for yourselves. We'll be having a separate session about this daily yoga practice and other things, but then do consider this overuse, misuse, and no use of joints. And it is also related with injuries. Like in many yoga classes, sometimes it happens that you focus only on one particular part and go on practicing those kind of poses which are related only with the knee, only with the lower back, or only with the neck, only with the shoulder, something like that. So that overuse of the joint, even in a yoga class, can lead to injuries. So when you are designing a yoga class, you are also supposed to see that you are involving all the joints and you are not focusing only on one single part and making your students to overuse that particular part. So it would be also one of the things which we'll be talking in injury prevention. So for the time being, I think I have covered most of the things which are related with yoga and the skeletal system. So hopefully I think we can stop here. Hari Om.